Hello, Professor Hoffmann. Thank you very much for coming. And could you please introduce yourself a bit to our audience, just briefly?
Yes, so I am Roald Hoffmann. I'm a chemist and a writer. I have been my entire professional career at Cornell University. I was born in Europe in what was then Poland and is now Ukraine. And I have been at Cornell University since 1965. I'm a theoretical chemist, but I do other things.
Thank you very much for coming once again. And you just mentioned that you were born in Zolchev, so the place which were Ukraine and is now Ukraine, formerly Poland, I guess.
Yes.
Could you please tell us a bit about your childhood? I guess it was not so easy childhood.
Yes, it was a difficult time. So I was born in 1937. That was a good time to be born for my family, but it was not a good time in retrospect from the point of view of the world. Before the Second World War broke out in 1939, when I was just 2 years old, and we were trapped and caught in it. We did not have a chance to escape, and we remained for the period of the war there. What made it particularly difficult, of course, was that we were Jewish. And we then faced the peculiar obsession of the Nazis with exterminating the Jews. At various points, various groups collaborated with the Germans, but in the end, we had a very difficult period from, especially from 1941 to 1944. From 39 to 41, we were under Soviet occupation. The Soviets and the Nazis callously divided Poland in that period. And then 41 to 44, we were under Nazi occupation. That was the worst time for us. In 1944, still a year before the World War II was over, we were freed by the Red Army. We remained in Poland we remained in that part. We're in Zolochiv now. For a while, and eventually went west in Poland following the Red Army, and eventually became refugees in Czechoslovakia, Austria, and Germany for 5 years, and lived in various refugee camps. But those refugee camps are not like the ones, let's say, that the Syrian refugees have to experience today. They were pretty good in post-war Europe, but it took 5 years for us to get to the United States, where we had relatives and we wanted to go. We could have wound up, and other relatives wound up, in places as distant from each other as Australia or in South America. But we eventually came to the United States in 1949. I was 11 and a half at that point. And from then on, we lived happily ever after. America was good to us. It gave me an opportunity for my education. And even though my parents, I had lost my father in a war, my mother remarried, I had a stepfather. Even though my parents could never work at what they were trained for before the war, and their lives suffered. For me, the world was open, and I took every advantage of it.
And what do you think, how has the war, the childhood which you experienced during the war, how has it influenced your personality?
Well, that's an interesting question. So maybe it's one to discuss with us psychoanalyst. I will say this, there are some remnants. To this day, I'm afraid of people in uniform, even of a doorman in a hotel who wears a uniform. But I don't like the sight of soldiers and policemen. So that is part of a fear that has remained from that wartime. Otherwise, I think there are different opinions and different outcomes of the war on various people, but I would say in my case that the fact of survival is by itself so affirmative of life for a thinking human being that it's you may think about why did I survive and not others, and people have talked about this, and it has led to depression in some people. But for me, just the fact of survival is a little analogous to the fact that now at age 85, I'm aging and my bones hurt. Okay, that's what happens to people as they age. But when I wake up in the morning and nothing hurts, that feels very good. It's an affirmative action on life. And in that sense, the survival was for me an affirmative action. I have remained an optimist about human nature, though in the times of Trump and Putin, I despair on that. But I remain an optimist about about there being something good in human beings. And I would like to enhance that, to make that come out. I am not a pessimist, and the war has not left me in that way.
It's very important that you say.
It's hard sometimes. It's hard to remain optimistic.
Yeah, and could you please tell us, one of the things that you mentioned was your trip to the place during the occupation, the hiding place that you mentioned before in your interviews. You said attic was reconstructed into chemistry classroom with Lomonosov's citations. So yes. Could you please tell us a bit more about that story?
Yes. So first of all, this is part of a longer story of what happened to us during the war. And I mentioned to you there were three difficult years, 41 to 44. At the end of that period, there were 15 months where we were hidden by a good Ukrainian school teacher and his family, his wife and three small children, in the attic of a schoolhouse in a small village not too far from Zolochiv, where I was born. The village is called today Univ. These people hid us out at great risk to their life. The risk was from Ukrainian policemen working for the Germans and the Germans. And they did so. And something to imagine is this family of two adults and three small children, that's the Ukrainian school teacher, took in four adults and one child. That's who they hid. My mother, my uncles and aunts, and me, into the attic of their house. But just think about the logistics in a small village of feeding five mouths in a dish when you have a family, and you have to get the food from whom? From your neighbors. This is a small village. There are no stores. Anyway, these people saved us, and we have kept in touch with that family ever since the war, for all except 10 years. 1944 to 54, we lost contact. We reestablished contact, and we have we helped them out in various ways, and I have visited there three times. I tried to visit during Soviet times, but because I spent a year in Moscow on an exchange in 1960, 61. But I was not allowed to visit that area. It was deemed to be a border area and sensitive. It wasn't. But anyway, after Ukraine became an independent country in 1990 or so, I could visit, but there were other reasons I delayed. And I didn't visit till 2006. And I have been back there three times. The last one was 6 years ago or so. The schoolhouse where we were hidden was still standing. And at one point, I went there. I went with my son, with my one time, another with my daughter, another time with my wife. At one point, when the first two times we were there, the schoolhouse was still standing. It has no longer there. The schoolhouse needed to be rebuilt. There's a brand new schoolhouse in Unyu. But in the previous times I was there, and this now refers to the episode that you mentioned, at one point during our hiding in that place, we switched to a room from the attic on the first floor, a storeroom. And that storeroom had since that time been rebuilt. Of course, the schoolhouse was changed from the time it was during 40, 50 years before then. And that where there was a storeroom, there was now a classroom. Still that same school, the single school serving this small village. You can imagine there were 25 students from every age, but this room was a science classroom. And on the wall of this room, under the floor of which room we had built a hiding place. We took out some of the floor planks, dug out a place to hide in the worst times. In that same room now, rebuilt, there was Mendeleev's table with a Lomonosov quotation in Ukrainian. The children in that room who were studying chemistry, they did not know my story at that time. Now they do, but they did not. But isn't that amazing that fate would bring about the fact that I became a chemist?
Yeah, it's truly unbelievable. Very, very nice story. And you just mentioned that you were 1 year in the USSR. You were working.
Yes.
How was it possible? And what you were doing?
Oh, that's so. Don't wonder about that. I'll explain. First of all, I was not a communist. That wasn't the reason that I went to the Soviet Union. But since 1959. There have been American graduate students, 40 or so, in the Soviet Union and vice versa. The Soviets sent engineers and scientists. Some of them became the leaders of Russian Soviet science, actually, very interesting. And the Americans sent historians and Slavicists. And my year, out of the 40, there were two scientists, and I was one of the two. And I went to study with Alexander Sergeyevich Davidov in a physical faculty of Moscow State University about exciton theory. I knew about Davidov's work from Harvard because someone had come and lectured about it. So anyway, I applied for that exchange. It was only 10 years after we had come to the United States. My mother thought I'd be drafted into the Soviet Army because I was born in Ukraine. Harvard thought I was crazy. Who takes a year off in the middle of graduate school? You do it in college, perhaps, but not in graduate school. Graduate school, that's you guys. You're supposed to be working all the time, right? So that's what people thought. It was crazy. I was newly married. My wife was from Sweden. It was for us a honeymoon. It was actually a wonderful time, and I don't regret it. But I spent a year in Moscow. I learned Russian. it wasn't hard. Polish was my native language, and I knew Ukrainian also, so it was okay. I learned Russian very well.
How did you find the Moscow State University, the state of the Soviet science in general at that time compared to one of the most nice universities in the US?
Yes. So at that time, the level, I was in a physics faculty, but I had interests in chemistry. So I had friends in the chemistry department. The physics was generally good, especially on the solid state physics side. The influence of Kapitsa, Landau, and their schools resulted in superb education in theoretical physics. In experimental physics, some areas were good, those that were tied to atomic bomb research, some areas were not good. Chemistry was a mixed bag overall. Some areas going back to pre-Soviet times were very good, like some organometallic chemistry. Some areas were not so good. 1960-61, when I was there, was when computers were just coming into research in the United States. My whole life is tied up to computers. That's another story. But the Soviet Union was very far behind. There were no computers available to research scientists. They were all in military installations. And that has remained a problem for the years that were to come after that. The basic technology was the same. In some ways, the engineering was better. Let me explain. If you have an NMR machine and you import the NMR machine from Varian in Switzerland that makes the machine, and you have one machine in Moscow at a research institute that works, when something goes wrong, and inevitably things go wrong with machines, you don't call the repairman from Switzerland, which is what you do in the United States. Mm. Instead, your own engineers have learned those machines very well and do the repairs themselves, improvising with parts, with other things. And that's what the Russians were good at, because they had to be good at that. So that was an interesting little side about equipment.
The next question is about the languages. You've mentioned that you are speaking Polish, Ukrainian, Russian, obviously English.
I don't longer speak some of these, but when I came to the US, English was my sixth language. That impresses only Americans. It would not impress someone in Belgium or Switzerland. The point is that if you are in Europe, and especially if you are in a refugee situation, you learn lots of languages. When we went from Poland to Czechoslovakia to Austria and Germany, no one asked me about, do you want to go to an English language school? They just put me into the local school and I had to learn whatever language was there. So it was that way. I have since that time learned a few more, French, Swedish, and I speak now. I cannot speak all those languages. I can speak Russian, Swedish, because that's my wife's language and we brought up our children bilingual Swedish English. English and German. So those are the only, I've kept those languages.
So with all these languages, how did you feel moving to America when you were a bit older than 10? How did you structure your life? How did you build it in Brooklyn? Because it should have been vastly different from Europe that you were in before.
We did not look back. There was nothing to look back to. What was there to look back to? People buried in the ground. Nor was there, you could say you could retain the hate, but we didn't. My mother and I didn't. Some people did have bad feelings about going back. Anyway, America gave us opportunities. We were real bona fide immigrants, and it was wonderful. Now, a side effect of that is that I was not too nice to my parents, who didn't speak English well, who didn't have jobs at first that taught them English, but they were jobs in factories doing something with their hands. And I was ashamed of my parents' English at first, and I made them speak. We at home, when we came, we spoke for various reasons at home interchangeably Polish, Yiddish, English, and German. But I made them, depending on who was talking to whom in our setting, I made my parents speak English. And, you know, I regret it. And there's something interesting in the United States that it's not only I, there was something very strong about Americanization, about becoming part of American society. And part of it was you didn't want your relatives to speak, your older relatives to speak the old languages from the old country. You know what changed the thing? I think that what changed it is political action by a Hispanic minority. That is, a growing number of students of young people from our families of immigrants from Latin America grew politically active, and somehow that has encouraged other countries to be more relaxed about keeping the original languages. No, I had no trouble with the society at all. I came in behind in knowledge of English and American history, of course, but I was ahead coming from Europe, as anyone would be, because of failures in American education. I was ahead in mathematics. And so I focused on that. Maybe that had something to do with going into science. Perhaps. There was no adjustment problem.
Now, probably a couple of questions regarding the science itself.
Yes, we should talk about chemistry.
Yeah. So the first question would be about the extended Hückel theory and about the Isolobal principle. Question is the following. Both of these, let's say, methods, they are more qualitative than quantitative. So they better describe the bonding, let's say, more in qualitative manner. And nowadays there are a lot of powerful computers, a lot of powerful softwares that enable us to perform ab initio calculations and to perform very time-consuming calculations to dig into the problem of the chemical bonding. The question is, why do we need still to develop some intuitively understandable methods compared to pure finding solutions to the Schrödinger equation, for example?
Okay, so first of all, let me, Igor Anand, let me talk about the two things you've mentioned are very different. It's just that you are too young to have experienced what the extended Hückel method was or used it. The extended Hückel method was one of the first sort of all valence electron methods for doing calculations in its own way for the period when it was somehow the state of the art method. That period was all of about 2 years long, okay? And that was about when I started it, 63, 63 to 65. When by 65 it was over, there were better methods. That was the beginning of computational chemistry. So it was calculations. And when Woodward came to me with a frontier orbital explanation of why butadiene closed in a certain way, but hexatriene in another way, what I said to Woodward was not that I believe you, but I said I have to do a calculation. That's a typical computational chemistry response. And I was already thinking in that way. The methods changed to include electron interaction partially in various ways through various semi-empirical methods, and then so-called ab initio, and then eventually DFT. So there are all these ways of calculating, but they were all in a way computational chemistry. The other thing that you mentioned, the isolobal analogy, that is not a computational method. That is a qualitative way of thinking. You're right about that. And so is, in general, orbital interaction. And so are correlation diagrams, maybe somewhere in between. Now, but what you're touching on, your question is, why do we still seem to need those particular qualitative approaches, or some other people would call them soft ways of thinking? I looked a little bit at your lectures in your courses, and of course you use those. You use arrow pushing, and you use some frontier orbital thinking about where the attacks take place. You use steric arguments, another soft way of thinking. We need those. Now, meanwhile, the calculations are evolving. And now the particular things that the community is enamored of are artificial intelligence tools like machine learning and neural networks. And the second thing that's in the offing is quantum computing. Now, quantum computing will solve Schrödinger's equation exactly, better than with any other method, and better than with any physical method with approximations that are increasing validity. It'll give you the numbers exactly, and it'll give you zero understanding. And if you ask the person, what if instead of a chlorine, I put in here a nitro group at this position on the ethylene? If you ask them, they'll be able to calculate for you eventually. They can't do it yet, but it's just a matter of 5 years at most, I think, for quantum computing. They'll get you the energy of the reactants, the products in a transition state exactly. And you will understand nothing, because you will not understand about what it is that makes it small or large, and how you could teach that to anyone. It's very interesting to see, even today, for me, it's amusing to see the disjunction in the best theoretical papers between the methods that are used to get the numbers and the qualitative explanations that go back onto the soft reasoning and frontier orbitals. It's amusing to see this junction between the two approaches that are used in those papers, because the papers, people who do the calculations, if they are talking to chemists, they know that the chemists want an explanation too. But not always. Sometimes the chemists just don't care. They really want what is the best molecule that'll bind to the spike protein of COVID-19 virus. And they really don't care in understanding why it binds so well. And I respect that, but I don't want us, what I really don't like is the claims that the artificial intelligence community is making of just because they get the numbers better than in any other way, that they understand it better. They don't understand a thing. To me, understand is what I can teach you, what you can help other students see. That's where understanding resides. It does not reside in plugging yourself into a computer. We are not in a world of matrix yet. We will be, perhaps, but I don't like that world at all. I want a world where human beings understand what they do.
Yeah, actually, I really understand what you're saying, because I'm also a computational chemist and working like that. That's why, yeah, it makes sense. Classical chemists come up quite often with questions, and you can just say, okay, here is the calculation, and you should.
That's fine. That's okay sometimes. A French theoretical chemist and I, Jean-Paul Malrieu in Toulouse, and I have written 3 essays in Angewandte Chemie in 2020 or 21 about this. The title of the 3 essays is Simulation versus Understanding, a Tension, and Not Only in Our Profession. But that summarizes where this question in some way. It's a question that every community in science is facing right now, and society as a whole as well. And it's a miracle we got these 3 articles published in Angewandte Chemie, because they're not the usual kind of articles. But then in the past, Angewandte Chemie was quite open to essays that discussed, things have changed, but it was quite open in the past to essays that discussed social historical issues. And I guess we were still in that. I would urge people to read those essays. They're not easy, but they try to define what understanding and simulation are, and what is the difference between them. And they also try to build a future. We're not going to avoid the machine learning and AI. It's here to stay, but how to coexist with it.
There is another question. So once in one of your interviews, you said, categories like beauty and ugly are in part genetically determined. In this sense, the question is, what do you think? Nowadays, we can predict the structures of various proteins, DNA, and so on. And if such categories like beauty and ugly are partially genetically determined, does it mean that at some point in the future, we would be able to compute them or not?
So I'm not sure where I said this, but I'm not sure I believe this any longer if I said it. I think what I may have meant is that there are some molecules and some also phenomena in nature that seem to be agreed on by people without much introduction. And what I'm thinking about are things that are, one thing of that type is things that are A, symmetrical in some way, and B, things that are simple. And I think the both are a particular danger for science, but they're also behind the fact that we, and I think this is what I said and where you read this, that we don't need anyone to tell us that Buckminster Fullerene is beautiful.
That's true.
But I needed someone to take me through the structure of hemoglobin for me to realize that this molecule is beautiful. And it's only when I knew its function, not only its structure, that it has four subunits, that there in each subunit there is nestled a heme group that is bound in a certain way, and that the heme group has an iron in it. And it's only when someone told me something about the mechanism of cooperativity of oxygen uptake in hemoglobin that I realized how beautiful this molecule is because of what it does. And it's so, so I think the Buckminster Fullerene is innate. The hemoglobin is learned in terms of criteria of beauty.
You mentioned that to provide this realization that you get after learning some concept or seeing this beauty, you need a person always to show you this beauty, to explain it to you.
Right.
Could you say that this person was Woodward for you as you worked with him? Do you think that there is some magic in passing a spark of genius from teacher to a student?
I think so. It's not entirely friendly, or sometimes the teacher, I usually refer to this in terms of master and apprentice. Sometimes which have a little feeling of that the master tells you what to do, which is not so good. But somehow sometimes the teacher may strike you initially as a severe taskmaster, asking you to do things that are difficult. And it's only later that you realize that they are useful in some way. But also, there are ways of teaching that avoid that feeling of being subjected to coercion in a process. Yes, the teacher-student relationship is very important. So can one, this is a question about machine teaching. So what I mean by this is, what's clear is that a computer can, judging the performance of a student on an exam or in real time solving a problem in a lecture situation or in a recitation, that the computer program can adjust the next set of problems to give to that person in such a way that is particularly suited to the lacunae, to the holes in the understanding of that person, so that the instruction can be individualized. And that's very difficult to do in a classroom with 20 people to whom you're talking. This is a basic problem of teaching. I think it's possible. I think I can, even in a lecture of 400, I've learned with time, and I'm proud of being a good teacher. I've learned how to communicate things even in that setting. But it's certainly an interesting thing is whether what is lost by not being able to individualize my instruction is gained instead by the human interaction between two human beings. And there's somebody, the teacher, who is there. And if the teacher can communicate that they, if the teacher can communicate to the student that they care that the student learn, but not be angry at them if they don't learn. But if they can communicate somehow that they care about the student understanding, that is very important. That's what good teachers can do. What good teachers can do. And a machine can't.
So you're quite, not quite, very successful chemist. And once you have said that the key to this success was the better ability to empathize with people. Could you please comment on a bit? So why is it so?
Well, so I'm in the front of this classroom and there are, let's say not 400, but let's say there are 100 kids out there. I'll call them kids, young people there. And I say something and I have to somehow integrate the nonverbal signals I get. I know that some of them have not slept enough and that's part their problem, part just society's. I have to somehow be able, but sometimes even without seeing them when I'm making up an exam, I have to somehow put myself into their place to share their degree of partial understanding, because they all have some partial understanding of the situation based on previous knowledge, yes, based on what they read, based on what they heard, based on what they see on your programs. And they somehow, I have to be able to feel out what it is that gives them the problem. And that's all that I meant by empathy, that I put myself in the student's position. Now, why do some people have such difficulty in doing this? I don't understand it. It seems obvious to me. You want to be a good teacher. So of course, you try to understand what people know and don't know.
So you actively advocate the adherence to ethical principles in chemistry and in science in general. So there is your quote, I'll read that right now. Whether you're making a gun or a molecule, a painting or a poem, you should always ask, could I do harm to someone? And you also signed the World Scientists' Warning to Humanity, if I'm not wrong. So what do you see? What are the current issues in this regard in physics? It's clear. But where do the issues of ethics and moral responsibility arise more actively right now in chemistry?
Well, the issues are there. How to resolve them remains a difficulty. So what are the issues? There are so many. Clearly, the perception of chemistry as being harmful, potentially harmful to human beings and the planet, is not a picture based any longer on what bothered people 100 years ago, which was poison gas use in World War I. Or neither is it actually a worry about the propellants that are used in the Katyusha rockets that the Russians are firing at the Ukrainians in their aggression. It's a concern more about things like the tons of plastic that we have put in the world for all for the purpose of making life easier, and are now blowing across the Sahara and congregating in gyres in the ocean, and people are concerned about this. Why can't we make those plastics be more biodegradable? Why can't we do the genetic engineering to evolve the bugs that could feed on those plastics, just to mention. There is more work that is needed there. There is concern about a general level of chemicals in the environment and the allergies and sensitivities that it leads in people. There is a general concern about the loss of species, which comes through complicated things, but through deforestation. So is that a chemical thing? Well, in a complicated way, if it has a chemical component in it. If one looks at what are the crops that are being raised to replace things, to replace the trees that have been knocked down. Anyway, I think there are concerns about chemistry, and I feel bad myself that I am not working on remediation and amelioration, on making things, on repairing things, and on making things better. This is one of the few things I feel bad about. I said I'm an optimist, but I feel bad that I'm insufficient because I have not worked on those things. So I know that the pure theory I have done has enabled others to do these other things. I think that's true. I think there are concerns for chemists. They have to do with the environment and with the role of chemicals in our environment and its effect on the planet and our bodies.
So in regards to what you said, do you feel that in science right now, we're moving from personal responsibility to a more collective responsibility right now, as we're all integrated?
Yes, but it also has to, the collective responsibility has to have its origins in personal responsibility. And the little bit that you do in recycling, and so going to the trouble of separating out stretchable plastics from various kinds of polyethylenes, which people in Europe and United States are always behind in the United States, but in Europe are very used to doing. The recycling practices have to become a part of human nature almost. Also in the United States, we waste a tremendous amount of energy. We're talking about electric cars, but meanwhile, we're using three times as much electricity already as are used in a typical household, for a typical dwelling of a certain kind of standard of luxury. We use much more. We don't know how to save on electricity. I think it is collective, but I think it begins at the personal level.
Okay.
So we have probably two more questions, very fast, very brief.
Try.
And that's it. So you're a poet. You have written a number of books, a number of poems. You're also active in theater. So could you please name probably a couple of your favorite books? I mean, not written by yourself,
not
but
written by me.
That you like.
So about chemistry, I think about chemistry, maybe for non-chemists, but it doesn't hurt for chemists. There are two, Primo Levi's The Periodic Table, a kind of biography in a form structured around the chemical elements. And there is a book by Oliver Sacks called Uncle Tungsten, which is a memory of his boyhood. Oliver Sacks is a well-known neurologist. So those are two books. On poetry, I would urge people to look at the work of an American poet called A.R. Ammons, A-M-M-O-N-S. He was my guru, but his poetry is not too hard. And they're not too hard to read. Poetry, of course, is difficult in another language. But I think one can read it. And I still like, since we share a bit of a Russian background here, I still like Bulat Okudzhava's songs to this day. So anytime you can sing those for me, then I know I'm talking to someone who is sensitive to the world. Part of it is it's young people talking to young people, but I don't mind being part of it. And you will find that there are other people who will join in this effort. You are doing this with your own work and enterprise, and people can feel that. You are also, I think, very correctly placing an emphasis on graphic character. And I can see that. And we made a series of films about chemistry 30 years ago. The animation, which today could be done by a high school student, was at that time the most expensive part of what we did. Animation is now much easier and can be used. So think about virtual reality.